Hi, I'm Kate Rowe. I'm the greenhouse coordinator here at Seed Savers Exchange.
And I'm Brennan Allsworth. I'm the field technician here at Seed Savers Exchange, and we're here to talk about soil health.
The soils that surround us are vastly important to everyone and everything. Think about it. The forest floor, our community gardens, our schoolyards, and of course the large farms that surround us. Soil is all around us. A healthy soil is the humble and crucial foundation beneath our feet.
But there's a big difference between your average soil and truly healthy soil. Picture a handful of soil scooped from the tree litter in the forest. Imagine how soothing it is to hold. Imagine the smell and the feel of it. The rich texture and abundance. Such healthy soil is what we want to replicate in our gardens. A rich soil full of life and vigor. There are four basic principles that help us grow and maintain these healthy soils. When practiced, these principles have profound benefits for our gardens and farms. And in turn, these benefits continue on to our community, our food systems, our local ecology, and beyond. Let's dig into the four principles of soil health.
The first principle is to minimize disturbance. A distinct quality of healthy soil is its structure. The term soil structure refers to the way soil particles are grouped together. The number of pores in the soil and the arrangement of these pores helps determine how well plant roots will grow. Soil structure also determines aeration, water and nutrient movement, compaction, and erosion. A tightly packed soil will result in less vigorous plants because the water, nutrients, air, organisms, and roots have less space in which to travel.
The healthiest soil has a fine, crumbly texture and is known as friable soil. A healthy soil structure is more open and contains a network of pores allowing for drainage and movement. These qualities are mainly influenced by the amounts of disturbance the soil receives, which is typically determined by how farmers go about tilling and plowing their fields. Soil structure and the living organisms within the soil are disturbed every time we plow or till. Excessive tillage can decrease the amount of organic matter in the soil and increase erosion. Because of this, many gardeners and farmers are turning to no-till practices.
Let me show you what we do here at Seed Savers Exchange Heritage Farm to minimize the disturbance of soil in our fields. As you can see here, Brennan is using a wheel hoe to weed the pathways in one of our gardens, instead of using machinery that would till the soil much more deeply. Using hand tools instead of tractors minimizes the disturbance of the soil and allows the organisms within the soil to remain unharmed. On the large scale, no-till farming requires fairly large and specialized machinery. But on a smaller scale, these practices can be put into use in the garden or small farm with various techniques, including hand tools or machinery.
The second principle is to maximize soil cover. One way to maximize soil cover is by cover cropping, which is when you plant a crop with the express purpose of covering the ground, rather than planting for harvesting. Cover cropping the areas of your farm or garden that aren't in production can be a great way to improve soil health. For instance, cover crops increase the amount of organic matter in the soil. They reduce erosion, suppress weeds, add nutrients to the soil, and attract beneficial insects and pollinators. The roots of cover crops also provide a home to beneficial fungi and microorganisms in the soil, which further improves the soil structure. Here at Seed Savers Heritage Farm, we cover crop our growing fields in fallow yards, as you can see here. We also grow hay for our cattle on land that would otherwise be bare.
No-till growing can involve cover cropping in the fall and then planting directly into the dyed-back cover crop debris in the spring. This keeps the soil structure intact and allows the organisms to remain undisturbed, leading to improved soil health. The previous cover crop residue can also act as mulch for your garden, increasing moisture retention and helping to control weed pressure. Here we can see this practice being put into action here at Seed Savers. We flail mowed the spring cover crop, and now we are using the grain drill to plant a new cover crop for the summer.
Another way to maximize soil cover is to mulch your garden. Mulch is any material added to the surface of the soil that suppresses weeds, retains moisture, and hopefully looks great too. Here at Seed Savers Exchange, we use organic, inorganic, and living mulch. Organic mulch includes wood chips, hay, straw, and chopped leaves. Here we have hay mulch in our vegetative allium bed. Inorganic mulches include plastic and landscape fabric. We put down landscape fabric in the pathways of our evaluation gardens this year to keep the weed pressure down and also to create obvious walkways for our guests. Living mulch refers to a ground cover of living plants seeded in pathways or interplanted with crops, like we have here in our garlic field. In addition to weed suppression and moisture retention, living mulch also improves soil health by maximizing the number of living roots in the soil. Good plants for living mulches include annual clovers, alfalfa, and annual ryegrass.
Throughout the season, the living mulch needs to be mowed to keep pathways walkable and to prevent it going to seed. Here is Brennan using the flail mower attachment on a walk-behind tractor in the pathways of our garlic field.
The third principle is to maximize diversity. Crop rotation is the practice of alternating different crops in the same area of your farm or garden across several seasons. It's a great way to reduce the amount of disease and pest pressure on your crops. If we were to plant tomatoes in the same spot year after year, diseases and pests specific to tomatoes would build up in the soil. So instead, we follow a tomato planting with another crop outside of the tomato family, giving those diseases and pests nothing to live on. We are planting the tomatoes in our eval garden in a different spot this year than last year to help minimize soil contamination.
Another reason to rotate crops is that different crop families take different amounts of nutrients from the soil. Certain families need more nutrients than others do throughout the growing season. These crops are called heavy feeders. Heavy feeder families include the cucurbit and nightshade families. Other crops, such as those in the legume family, fix nitrogen in the soil. So it's a good idea to follow a legume planting with a heavy feeder crop, like a pea followed by a squash.
Incorporating livestock into your crop rotation is another way to maximize diversity and improve soil health. For example, allowing a flock of chickens to forage either before or after vegetable production can reduce weed and pest pressure and add beneficial fertilizer to the soil.
The fourth principle of soil health is to maximize the presence of living roots. To maximize living roots, it's important to keep plants in the ground year-round. Microbes in the soil feed off of the roots, while the roots release nutrients, carbon, and sugars into the soil. This, in turn, attracts fungi, which form a system of filaments that act as extensions of the root system. The filaments help the roots to absorb water and nutrients from the soil. These fungi, together with beneficial bacteria and other organisms, make up the root microbiome, which sustains, protects, and feeds the plant. A fall planting of wheat can provide living roots throughout the winter, which is normally a fallow period, while seeding a mixture of plants with varying root depths improves soil aeration.
Applying these four principles to the soils that you steward and experiencing the results is an ongoing process full of patience and good work. Over time, you will notice some beneficial changes to your garden. Observation is an excellent monitor for this. The next measurement, if you wish to get down to the nitty-gritty, is a soil test.
Soil testing provides information about the pH level or acidity of the soil, as well as the amounts of certain nutrients contained in the soil, most notably nitrogen, phosphorus, and potassium, but also calcium, magnesium, and sulfur. Soil pH is rated on a scale from 1 to 14, with 7 being neutral. Most plants grow best in soil with a pH between 6 and 7, with 6.5 being ideal. If the pH is not within that range, an amendment such as lime may be recommended. If nutrient levels are lower than ideal, fertilizers or compost may be recommended.
A soil amendment is anything added to the soil to improve its physical properties, including water retention, drainage, aeration, and general soil structure.
There are two types of amendments, organic and inorganic. Organic amendments add organic matter to the soil, which helps feed the roots, aerates the soil, and helps with water and nutrient retention. Organic amendments include peat, compost, and composted manure. Inorganic amendments include things like vermiculite, perlite, and sand. Knowing what type of soil you have will help determine what kind of amendment to add. For example, if you have sandy soil, you may want to incorporate compost and peat to boost the amount of organic matter, as well as increase water retention. However, if you add sand to clay soil, you end up with a structure similar to concrete. Building healthy soils by adding amendments takes time, but the result is much happier, healthier, more robust, and resilient plants, which means healthier, more nutritious, more delicious food.
The recognition of soil as a living entity helps the gardener and farmer see that soils are a dynamic foundation to plants, critters, and all forms of life.
Soil breathes, moves and transforms nutrients, and interacts with its environment. Soil is absolutely incredible.
If you would like further information on soil health, we recommend looking for courses or workshops through your local Ag Extension, a regional farmers organization, or resources like the Rodale Institute. Enjoy and have fun.